Thank you very much. In your view, what do you think is the biggest challenge to the practice of architecture in this country? What is the biggest stumbling block?
I've stopped practicing for a long time, but I know,
like, during your time
that supervision is very difficult, because some of the good buildings you see around, those which were built on campus, the foremen, you know, the contractors were Italian or Swiss, and they brought young men, technically qualified young men from their countries to be foremen or site architects. And you know, our masons, carpenters, very few of them have good training. They can't read the drawings. And so when you're an architect and you're supervising a Ghanaian contractor's work, it's very difficult, because they're not well trained. That is the biggest challenge I know. But with the professionals, they're just as competent as you can get anywhere. You know, architects, engineers, and so on. Only we have the difficulty we have. I think now it must have improved, was services engineers.
Okay.
They didn't have very experienced services engineers. You know, lifts, air conditioners, and so on. You know, that was a difficult thing. So you had to depend on foreign firms. But I believe, as I said, now engineering
has
advanced. I'm quite sure it's good. But supervision, you see, the Ghanaian artisan, it's very difficult. He hasn't trained very well, and those who have worked with good firms like A. Lang and so on know they, when you get them, they're very, very, very good. But those who work under them, they know what to do, but if you're not watching them, they will just, everything will be crooked and they go away. So you have to really sit on them. You know, you see that it's written in the contract that constant supervision is not the job of the architect. But you let something go wrong, and you see that constant supervision is the job of the architect.
Okay, Prof. What is your favorite building in Ghana? Do you have a favorite building?
Oh, I don't think there should be anything like that. My own building is my favorite.
Favorite building. which building could that be?
Buildings have been built under different circumstances and so on. I mean, when you take proportions and this thing, I mean, very simple. Buildings like the Parliament House, it's not Parliament House actually, it's just Conference Center. I think in proportions and so on, it's one of the nicest buildings we have in Ghana. I don't know whether you'll agree.
I think
at that building.
The Conference Center.
From ground to roof, and look at the proportions and so on. They are among the nicest buildings. My own boss, I worked for Kenneth Scott for just 2 years before I came to tech. But now, you see, I don't often go to Accra. Most of the buildings are in Accra now.
Yes.
But Kumasi hasn't had its fair share of buildings. New buildings, honestly. But a lot of buildings are springing up at Tech, but they don't seem to follow any, you know, they are all different. You see, our first buildings can be identified, but they belong to a certain age. But the present buildings, you know, seem to belong to anything.
Based on that comment that the first buildings at Tech, KNUST, were following a certain order or pattern, but the new ones, they don't seem to follow anything. Do you think as a nation, we should have a specific or peculiar style of architecture?
Well, this is a question which has never been answered correctly and will never be answered correctly. You see, when you go to India, you know, about 16th, 17th century, they had the Taj Mahal. You know, when you come closer, they have the Indian Parliament building, as I said, designed by certain Latvians. When you go to the Sahara Desert, you know, this Muslim country, you see the, how they use the earth, you know. So, their young architects are something to hang on to base something on. Unfortunately, apart from planning, features architecture itself we don't have much to depend on, except, as I said, planning wise we have something to depend on, but the form of the building itself, it's very difficult to put your finger on something that could act as a catalyst, you know, for the young architect to, you know, base anything on. Because we didn't use permanent materials. We didn't know how to use stone. You know, even what you call fish, or mud, as others call it, or adobe. They didn't go very far. I mean, they're single story. Even if it was double story, it was half timber. And they didn't last long. You know, they were not properly maintained. And so one has to be really innovative to be able to create something that you can call Ghanaian. Apart from decorations, you know, bristly decorative ornaments on buildings, finding it difficult to pinpoint what can be called Ghanaian. Even the north, the climate dictates the kind of building, but again, if you don't go to the Sahelian area, and that's been influenced by the Muslim architecture, religion and architecture. All you see, I mean, I can distinguish the Dagomba roof from the others. Apart from, and they are also not long life. Every year you have to change them. So we have a problem. The Basel missionaries tried to use timber in a way that has lasted very long. They used stone and timber. The Basel missionaries, missionary architecture, was very good. But we didn't learn much from the castles and forts.
So, what went wrong?
What
went wrong? that we cannot, as a people, we cannot have, you know, specific influences?
Well, nothing went wrong, you know. I mean, our recorded history is from what date? Look, the pyramids were built about 4,000 years before Christ. Ashanti can put his fingers on history. Osejutu died exactly 300 years last year. And, you know, civilization that lasts, and they're fighting all the time. You know, maybe the military can gain something from their strategies and so on, but for building, it's difficult. They were not nomads. But whatever they built, you know, in the north, for instance, any time they fought, they burned the thing down. You know, not that our people were not clever, but they didn't settle long enough. You see? They didn't settle long enough. And then also, the social movements. A lot of European architecture, Asian architecture, are all based on religious movements. They have their origin from religious movements, most of them anyway. When you study history of architecture, most of it's, you know, from Egyptian days. It's religious, isn't it?
Yeah.
Even when you come to, okay, Persian days and so on, the way they had kings, very powerful kings, who ruled for many, 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 many years. And their influence could last a long time. And when you had the Jewish religion from the time of Abraham. Okay, the biggest monument of the temple, but it wasn't much, it wasn't a very big building. When you study it, it's not a big building. But then after that, you know, those who followed Christ, you know, Romanesque buildings before you came to Gothic, came to Renaissance. Most of the buildings were religious. Greek, Parthenon, Acropolis, all religious buildings. And we didn't have any big religious movement. One village would have 77, you know, gods. You know, a place called Brekusu, near Buri. They had over 70 gods, you know, fetishes. So if the problem with Africa is that we haven't had any big religious movement apart from Egypt. And then we didn't have, the Roman government, for instance, was a very powerful thing, you know, conquered all the way to the east. And when you talk of Japanese architecture Chinese architecture. They're all pagodas, they're all Buddha and all these, they are religious. But we didn't have a big religious movement until the Europeans came in, and the Arabs also came in with their Muslim religion. It's a very, very important factor, you know, because development of architecture is developed around movements, social movements.